We're glad to be sharing the ministry of Redemption Church with you. Now join us as we receive the Word of God.
God, you're so good. We love you. Amen. Thank you for worshiping with us today. You may be seated. We do those three things every time we come to Redemption. What was number one? Everybody worships. And y'all did that today. I felt God's presence while y'all were worshiping. I loved it. Number two, we're about to do. What is that? Everybody receives the Word of God. And number three, before today's over, we want you to do the third thing, and that's everybody talks to God. We want you to spend some time before today's over talking to the Lord. Amen. Hello, champions. Are there any champions in the room today? Yeah. Excellent. My name is Chris Fluitt, and I'm blessed to serve here at Redemption Church as lead pastor. All right, and we're in the fourth week of our champion series. We've been looking all these weeks at the same story. What is that story we're looking at? David and Goliath, that epic story. Week number one, remember we told you that promise trumps pedigree. No matter what other people think about you, when God gives you a promise, you can depend on it with all your heart. Week number two, we told you that servants are champions. David came to the battlefield, not with a sword, but with a sandwich. How about that? All right, week three, you need to see more than the problem. He was able to look past the problem, and he saw promise, he saw power, he saw that he could persevere, he saw that he could praise in the middle of his promise, and before, in the middle of the problem, he could praise, and before it was all said and done, it was no longer a problem, but an opportunity for promotion. All right, and then last week, we told you about the full court press, that sometimes you just got to go. You've had enough strategy talk. You've had enough advice. Sometimes it's just time to go out and get that job. Go out and apply for that scholarship. You just go and do it. Sometimes you just need to go and tell your friend about Jesus. No, an angel hasn't come to you to tell you yet, but does an angel have to come to tell you? Go put the full court press on. Today, I want to preach to you. But I want you to preach with me. I'm in a church today that'll preach with me a little bit. All right. Is that all right? All right. Some of y'all are like, I'm not so sure if we're in that kind of church. But work on it. Today, I've got a sermon entitled, Poor Giant, You Never Stood a Chance. All right? And when you hear me say today, poor giant, here's your opportunity to preach with me. When I say poor giant, I want you to say the second half of this sentence. You never stood a chance. Let's practice. Poor giant, you never stood a chance. All right, I like it. Do you like underdog stories? Anybody like underdog stories? I like them until my team is the overdog. My Baylor Bears just got upended by the number 7 South Carolina Gamecocks, and I didn't enjoy that so much, but I usually like to see the little guy overcome great odds and win the victory. Yeah. I usually like that. I really like that. And every March Madness in the NCAA tournament, there is a team that comes out of nowhere to defeat a highly ranked team. It happens every year, and it always destroys my bracket. Like, I'm burning my bracket by the second day, always. As these surprising teams make their way through the tourney, they often develop a name. Anybody know the name of these low-seeded teams that make it through a tourney? Big sports fans here, they're called Cinderellas. They're called Cinderellas. How did they find their self at this big dance here? Cinderellas, that's what they're called. Cinderella was not invited to the royal dance, but somehow with magic she made her way to the dance floor. She won the heart of the prince. And that's what we get with some of these schools. Some of these schools you've never even heard of. Or if you try to say their names, you Quinnipiac? I still don't know how to say that school, all right? Last March, we had such a case. Last March, the Michigan State Spartans. Have you ever heard of Michigan State? Is that a small school? No, it's a big school. You've heard of Michigan State. The Spartans. They were ranked number 2 in the NCAA tourney, and they were mad about it because they felt that they played well enough to earn a number 1 ranking. If you don't know, they rank all the teams, all right? There's 64 of them. But Michigan State is a well-respected basketball program. It's got a Hall of Fame coach named Tom Izzo. And this program, it's won many championships and is often seen playing in the Final Four. And this year, they are ranked high. Michigan State was a giant. In fact, more people last year bet in Las Vegas that Michigan State was going to bring home the trophy that year. When the tournament started, everybody was certain that team is going to go far in the tourney. In fact, I'm putting my money on the Spartans. I didn't. I'm not saying Shelton did, but I didn't. All right, Shelton didn't do it. He doesn't even know who they are, right? But the number two ranked team, right, always draws a small team, a lower ranked team. And these teams, like, barely make the tournament. A number 15 ranked team doesn't have any All-American players. There are usually no future NBA stars on a number 15 ranked NCAA tournament team. The fans of these teams are actually just happy that they made the tournament. They're just celebrating like they won the tournament just by making the tournament. You get the picture. In fact, they're just going, oh, we made the tournament. This is awesome. I hope we don't lose by 50. That would be awesome. That would be so good. We'd brag about this for 10 years if we like only lost by 30. That'd be great. Seriously, that's how this works, all right? More people bet money on this Michigan State team than anyone else. And here they are playing a team. People are like, oh, they have a basketball program. So what was going to happen? Michigan State was the giant, and they would play against Middle Tennessee Blue Raiders. Go Blue Raiders. Are there any Blue Raiders fans in the house today? Anybody, anybody Middle State Blue Raider fan? Anybody got the jersey at home? Can anybody tell us who's the best basketball player in Middle Tennessee history? I'll wait. Somebody's going to Google it. All right. The Spartans entered the court like this first-round game was a mere formality, because in many people's ideas, it was. They had the talent, they had the prestige, they had the ranking. They, in no way in the world should they have felt any different. They should have entered that court like they were in the control. But you know what? Those Blue Raiders had a different idea. Poor Giant. You never stood a chance. That number 15 team played with fierce tenacity and an offense that would not be denied. And no matter what the Spartans tried, the other team was just better on that day. And you'd be wrong to think, well, maybe Michigan State had a bad game, because that's the weirdest thing about it. If you look up the box score, Michigan State shot 55%. Is that good if you don't know about basketball? Yeah, that's great. In fact, if you look up their stats, that's the best they've ever shot in an NCAA tournament game. 55%. And they were doing their best, but it's like whatever they did, this Blue Raider, this upstart team, this number 15 team, this team that we don't even know any of their players, was just better. Whatever Michigan State did on defense, Middle Tennessee was just better. Whatever Michigan State tried to do on offense, Middle Tennessee was just better. When Michigan State called a timeout and said, guys, okay, we tried that. That didn't work. Let's try this. It didn't matter. They had an answer for everything. This Middle State Blue Raider number 15 team knocked off number two, Michigan State Spartans. Can I tell you something? The rankings don't matter. The rankings don't matter. And you see, that's a part of our problem in life, because we like to know where we rank with people. Is our society built on how many likes they get on Instagram? Does anybody have a friend that gets upset if you didn't like their pictures of their vacations? All right, Shelton does. All right. That's how it is. Oh, I have so many followers on blah, blah, blah. And that really matters. Like, that ranks with you. That ranks with people. What's going on? It doesn't matter how highly or how lowly someone thinks about you. Now, can I preach to myself a little bit? Because Chris Fluitt needs to hear that every once in a while. It doesn't matter what people think about you, Chris Fluitt, if they think highly or if they think lowly. If they are ranking you high or ranking you low, that is not what matters. Throw out the rankings. The rankings don't matter. Goliath stepped out onto the battlefield, the clear number one. Yeah. He was the clear number one pick. All the money was on Goliath. He was chosen by his nation to be their champion. And let me tell you, it was not a hard choice. The guy was over 9 feet tall. We've talked about his weapons. This guy looked dangerous. Every player in the NBA is way shorter than this dude. Every player in the NBA wouldn't want to tangle with this guy right here. Any football player you can picture didn't want to touch this guy. This guy was clearly the number one seed. You get me? You follow me? He clearly ranked. He was undefeated. He had killed many men. They said, we just need to kill one man in a battle. All right, this dude can do it. He just pulls people apart. He kills them and it's bloody. And actually, let's get our popcorn because this is going to be a bloodbath first round game. All right? David stepped onto the battlefield. And he was completely unranked. In fact, you can't even rank him 15. Because he's actually unranked. He didn't even make the tournament. He wasn't invited to the battlefield. He wasn't a part of the military. He didn't have a sword. He didn't have a suit of armor. He was unranked. That would be like the basketball team showing up without a basketball, without basketball shoes or a basketball uniform. That is how unranked this dude was. Israel did not choose David. The Philistines chose Goliath. But none of Israel, the king or David's brothers or anybody, chose David. He was unranked. No one would have described him as a champion. In fact, this was his first appearance ever in a battlefield. He had never stood before a warrior before. He had never fought a man before, especially against a warrior like Goliath. I'm sure that more than one person in the crowd that day thought, poor little David. Poor little Dave. I hope his death is really quick. You know, I hope it's quick and he doesn't suffer too much. Because, oh my, poor Jesse, David's dad. Poor Jesse and poor David. Oh my gosh, this is going to be so sad. But is that how the story goes?
No,
it's not. It was not poor David. Poor giant. You never stood a chance. Somebody help me. Poor giant, you never stood a chance. Am I preaching to anybody that is facing a giant somewhere in their life? Am I preaching to anybody today that feels like you are not ranked? Am I preaching to anybody today that feels like people don't even think you belong where you are? Maybe you're on the job and people say they don't deserve that job or they don't deserve that situation. Maybe you're in relationships where somebody said they don't deserve that. They don't deserve. Maybe God's blessing you, but people are saying you don't deserve that. You are unranked. You are not recognized. Am I preaching to anybody that feels like they're unranked, unknown, and the underdog? Am I? I have a war cry for you today, and here it is. Poor giant, you never stood a chance. You see, I feel sorry for your giant. I feel sorry for your giant today. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm mad at your giant. Because he's standing in your way. I'm mad at your giant. He's trying to keep you from your victory. But when I look out on the battlefield through the lens of God's inevitable victory, I actually feel bad for your enemy. I feel bad for your giant. Is anybody understanding what I'm saying? Do you know that the Bible tells you to love, bless, and pray for your enemies? Doesn't that sound like a strange thing to say? Sometimes my idea in the past has been, you know, to pray to stop them, right? Pray for your enemies. Okay, I'll pray for my enemies. Lord, stop them. Yeah, hurt them good. That's not what it says. That's not what it's saying. It's actually praying for them, praying for their benefit, loving them for a benefit, blessing them towards a benefit. Isn't that crazy? Isn't that ridiculous? Let me give you some insight on that. Do you know that your Bible doesn't tell you to seek revenge against your enemies? Maybe we need to Spend some time thinking about that. Stop trying to get revenge on people. Stop having those inner conversations with yourself that says, oh man, they called me that, but I should have said, hey, is the jerk store open because they ran out of you? Seinfeld reference. All right. Stop thinking about those things. You know, those conversations that you do play over in your head over and again. They said this, but I should have said that. And then they would have felt bad. And then they would have said this, but I said, yeah, but remember that time. And you, even in your head, you're trying to get revenge in the petty head argument that doesn't even exist. And you spend a lot of emotional energy doing that. Stop doing that. The Bible tells you to love your enemy, to bless your enemy, to pray for your enemy. It tells you not to seek revenge against your enemy. In other words, don't stay mad at your enemies in your life. Don't worry about the enemies in your life and treat your enemies more like friends. That's what it's like to be in the kingdom of God. But if I don't fight my enemies, like my enemies need to be fought. So if I don't fight them, Junior, who's going to fight them? Junior, I'm so glad you asked. Deuteronomy chapter 20, verse 3 and 4 tells us very clearly. He shall say, hear Israel, today you are going into battle against your enemies. Do not be faint-hearted or afraid. Do not panic or be terrified by them. Verse 5, here's the reason why. For the Lord, your God, is the one who goes with you to fight for you against your enemies to give you victory. Anybody like that verse? Can you clap your hands if you like that verse? Anybody excited that the Lord is going before you? Redemption Church, who's going to fight your enemy? It's the Lord, your God. Wait a second. You mean the Lord, your God's going to fight the giant? Poor giant. You never stood a chance. My goodness, you can stand a chance against Chris Fluitt. Absolutely. You can absolutely stand a chance against me. I wouldn't give myself much a puncher's chance in a fight, all right? Especially if there's swords involved, right? Okay, just warning to you, I bruise very easily, all right? I'm a very fragile person. I don't get in fights of that nature at all. But the Lord is the one that's going to fight my battles. That's why it says don't panic. Don't be afraid. You know what? If you're panicking and you're afraid, it's because you forgot who's fighting your battles. The Lord's going to fight your battles. Amen. Poor giant, you never stood a chance. Psalm 118, 5 through 8. This is our memory verse. I hope you got it in your heart. It says, push to the wall. I called to God from the wide open spaces. He answered. God's now at my side. And I'm not afraid. Who would dare lay a hand on me? You ought to have a little attitude. You ought to have a little, you know, there's this one comic, like a cartoon, right? And there's Spike the big dog. And then there's like this little yappy dog, right? And the yappy dog talks really tough and has an attitude because Spike is there. Having his back, right? And then Spike, something happens to Spike. I think he thinks he's a cat suddenly. And so now the dog's in trouble, right? The little yelpy dog. Y'all got me? It's in your Bible, guys. I mean, serious. That's not in your Bible. Yeah. All right, it's Looney Tunes. But when the Lord is fighting your battles, you ought to have a little attitude when you take the field. All right. When you step onto the court. When you go into that job interview, you ought to feel like you're going to get that job interview. You ought to feel like you deserve that job interview. All right? Because the Lord is with you. You follow me? Are you with me? All right? Okay. Look at this next verse. It says, God's my strong champion. Who's your strong champion? God. Now remember, who was Goliath? He was the Philistines' champion. Who was Israel's champion? Well, somebody volunteered themselves and wandered out there. But that dude named David says that God was his champion. I like this. I flick off my enemies like flies. Far better to take refuge in God than trust in people. Do you know how many promises are yours in the Bible? You know how many promises? Here's the number. There are 5,467 promises from God in the Bible. 5,000, say it, 5,467 promises. And every one of them is true. And every one of them is yours. Now, I like to tell you this. No matter what giant is standing in front of you, no giant has ever been able to defeat one of his promises, much less 5,467 of them. Right. Don't you understand that your enemy has never been able to defeat one of the promises of God? Poor giant, you never stood a chance. David walked out there with the promises of God that no one can defeat. I want to tell you like this. The walls of Jericho, you know the story of Jericho, this big walled city, and no one thought that that city could be defeated by anybody, especially some Israelites that are wandering around it. What a great strategy this is. Let's just wander around the city and maybe we'll defeat it. And everybody's like, poor Israel. But nuh-uh. Israel has the promise of God. It's poor Jericho. You're the one that never stood a chance. The walls of Jericho fell as Israel praised the Lord. The Midianite army was an army of 135,000 well-armed soldiers, and Israel had a huge army of 300. And their general was a guy who a few chapters early was hiding in a vat that makes wine, right? That's the story. That's how the story goes. And everybody that looked at that situation said, poor Gideon, poor Israel, they're going to get murdered. It's going to be a bloodbath. Oh, but you forgot something. You were looking at the wrong rankings. I see the score as 5,467-0 because Israel has the promise of God. It's not poor Israel. It's poor Midian. You never stood a chance. When Israel, you know, Israel won that battle, defeated that enemy without ever drawing a sword. Do you remember what they did? They had a clay pitcher with a candle inside. They broke the clay pitcher, and then the light shined forth, and then they blew the trumpet in praise, and that was enough to defeat the enemy. Yeah. I tell you, you want to know what that means real quick? There's this clay. What does that represent? That represents your flesh. That represents you. What does the light represent? That represents the gospel. That represents Jesus. That represents God. That represents His Spirit. It's inside of you. And you need to let this light pour out from your life in praise, and you'll defeat the enemy every time. That's what it is. You ought to worship the Lord. It'll defeat the enemy every time. How about this story? Anybody know this story? Our Lord Jesus experienced a brutal death. Brutal death. So brutal that most of the people that knew Him weren't even there. They couldn't watch it. We only know one disciple that was there. It was John. Everyone else was afraid. Our Savior was buried in a grave. Jesus descended into hell. Oh man, if being brutally murdered wasn't enough, if being buried wasn't enough, how about descending into hell? We feeling bad about this situation enough yet, right? But God's Word promised. God's Word promised that the Messiah would live forever as an everlasting Father. That's what it said. God's Word promised that the Anointed One would reign forever on David's throne. The promised seed of Israel, it was promised. The promised seed of Eve would crush the head of the enemy. So while everybody was saying, poor Jesus, He was brutally murdered, and Friday passed. And they said, poor Jesus, He was brutally murdered, and another day passed. Poor Jesus, He, on that next morning, oh man, it wasn't poor Jesus. You know what it was? It was poor death. Where is your sting? It was poor grave. Where is your victory? And it was poor hell. Somebody say poor hell. Poor hell. Poor hell. Look at Revelation chapter 1, verse 18. Look what Jesus says right here. I am the living one. I was dead, and now look. Oh my goodness. I could just preach about that for a little bit. I was dead, but now look. I am alive, and forever and ever I hold the keys of death and hell, death and Hades. Somebody clap your hands for that God. Poor death, poor grave, poor hell. you never stood a chance. Psalm 37 and 25 says this, I was young and now I'm old, yet I have never seen the righteous forsaken or their seed begging bread. You feel sorry for yourself? You're like, poor me, I don't have enough money. You need to get a hold of some of the 5,467 promises of God that are true and for you, and get a hold of this. Don't say poor bank account. I've never seen the righteous forsaken. I've never seen his seed begging bread. Poor empty cabinets. Oh, you are looking at the wrong rankings. Get a hold of God, because the righteous are never forsaken. His seed is never begging bread. That's the promise of God. I dare you to stand on the promise of God and look your enemy in the eye and say, I feel bad for you. How about this one, Isaiah 57 and 17? These are just some of the promises that you ought to be standing on every time a problem happens. Maybe you've heard this one. Isaiah 54, 17. Somebody say the first two words. No weapon formed against you will prevail, and you will refute every tongue that accuses you. This is the heritage of the servants of the Lord, and this is their vindication from me, declares the Lord. You're saying, poor me? Poor me, look at that giant, he's bigger than me. Poor me, he's got better weapons than me. Poor me, more people think highly of him than me. No weapon formed against you will prosper. It doesn't matter what weapons the giant had. While David is going out to defeat Goliath, it's one of the most harmful things that happened to him ever, I think. His brother Eliab looks at him and says, what are you doing here? I know your heart. You're just up to no good here. You're just playing around, trying to make people think something of you. How many know words from people that are close to us tend to hurt more than any other? Oh, but what does it say? No weapon formed against you will prosper, and every tongue that accuses you, you will refute. Another version says it like this, God will condemn those words. You don't even have to condemn them. God will condemn them. Eliab couldn't be more wrong. David's brother was completely wrong when he said, I know your heart. You didn't know David's heart. God knew David's heart. God knew David's heart, and that's why Eliab, wake up, because the earlier chapter, the chapter right before this, that's why you were passed over by Samuel, but God spoke to Samuel and said, this is the one. People look on the outer, but God looks on the heart, and I pick this guy. Don't listen to people that say they know your heart. They don't know your heart. God knows on your heart, because he doesn't just look on the outward. He looks on the inward. Hallelujah. Amen. Can I tell you something? That your giant is an undone enemy. Every weapon he is trying to kill you with, it's going to fail. Every lie that he tells against you, God's going to condemn it himself. Not only will your enemy defeated, not only will your enemy be defeated, but I like this part. Some of you need to hear this part. Everything your enemy has done is going to be undone. You have an undone enemy. Satan, our adversary, the devil, that's what his name means right there. Our adversary, right? He's the biggest loser of all time. Can we talk some trash real quick? Anybody okay? Anybody got a chip on their shoulder like a 15th seed, like they're just going to come in and win the tourney today? Are there any Blue Raiders in the house? All right, let's talk about the devil like we're brave. Hey, he is a loser. He's not just a loser, he's a pretty stupid loser, because he's lived way longer than all of us. He's existed like forever since he was created. We aren't even told when he's created. He's created. He's lived all this time. But you know what his future is? Let me tell you about his future. Revelation prophesies that he will be chained up by a single, nameless angel. There's a scene in your Bible where Satan is on a chain and he is being led around by a, somebody say it with me, single, nameless angel. This angel wasn't even powerful enough to get a name. It doesn't say that he was led around by a horde of angels, led by Michael and Gabriel, the archangel. It doesn't say that. It says one nameless angel. I like to think of him as private dude angel. He's just like some private. It's like lower guy. He's like God's like, hey, you, dude, you're doing a good job sweeping, but can you take this chain and lead him? He's like, yes, sir, right away, sir. And he's just pulling around. Because that is the kind of loser we're dealing with. He doesn't have the power to overcome a single angel. He wants you to think he's got a lot of power over you. He wants to think that he's the one in charge. Man, I know what your future is. It's one of the promises I have from God. One nameless single angel is going to take you on that chain and throw you into the lake of fire. Satan, you are undone. And everything that you've ever done is going to be undone. You look at an unbelievable promise in the Bible. This is one you got to know. It's Colossians chapter 1, verse 19 and 20. This is one of the most hopeful scriptures in all the Bible. You look at it. For God was pleased to have all his fullness dwell in him. Who's the him here? Jesus. Do you realize that when we talk about Jesus, we're not just talking about a dude who was a carpenter. We're not just talking about a guy who was a good man. We're just not talking about a guy who was a good storyteller who had a terrible death. We are talking about a man who had the fullness of God in him. He was God in the flesh. He was God come to earth to walk around, to fight our battles, to win our hearts, and to love us. And one day this very same Jesus is going to return. Hallelujah. Praise God. Verse 20. And through him. Who's the him? Jesus. Y'all are smart. Y'all are like Bible scholars up in this house. I love it. Through Jesus to reconcile to himself some things. Oh, did I read that? A few things that he chooses. The things that you really pray about and you're good. I'm just reading this all wrong. Whoa, I'm breaking things like that. All right, that's what I get for changing scripture. I'm so sorry, Lord. All right. And through him to reconcile to himself, somebody say it with me, all things, whether things on earth or things in heaven, by making peace through his blood shed on the cross. All right, so what does this? His blood shed on the cross. How powerful is the blood shed on the cross? Well, it gives you peace, but also it does this. It reconciles. It fixes. It cleans up. It restores. It put all the brokenness of everything, of all things, the blood of Jesus brings it all back together. So now let's apply this to the biggest loser that has ever been anywhere, the devil, Satan. Through Jesus, God will reconcile to himself all things on earth and all things on heaven. So I want you to imagine all the work, all the effort of Satan, his devils and demons. I want you to imagine as long as they've existed and all they've tried to do, all their mischief in the garden, all their mischief with Cain, all their mischief when they were trying to tempt Jesus, all their mischief everywhere, all that he's trying to do in your life and wreck your life. Their resume, do you know what the resume of these demons includes? Here's some of the things. Death, murder, stealing, lying, divorce, depression, suicide, hatred, racism, sexism, addiction, abuse, rape. We could go on and on. Everything that is bad is on their resume. Now imagine all things being reconciled back to God. Imagine every bit of what he's tried to accomplish being ripped out of him, covered by the blood of Jesus, and put back together. What a loser. What a loser. Poor giant. You never stood a chance. Poor, you didn't even have business walking on this court today. Every bit of that he has tried to accomplish, God is going to undo through the blood of Jesus. I need somebody to clap their hands and get excited about that truth right there. Can I tell you, it's going to happen. It is going to happen. Can you look at somebody and just say, it is going to happen. He's going to reconcile all things. All things. Oh my goodness. I hate having accomplishments taken away from me. Everything that Satan's ever accomplished, he's not going to have one thing left. What a loser. Poor giant. You never stood a chance. The things that are broken inside of you. We talked enough about that loser. Let's talk about you. You're not a loser. But there are hurting things inside you. Maybe you have some things in the past that they hurt you bad. They messed you up real bad. There's some broken things in you. The things about you that you've tried to fix, but no matter how hard you've tried to fix, they're still broken. You know those things I'm talking about? The things that you're afraid that one day somebody might figure out about you, so you like keep that really quiet. There's huge blocks of your life that you kind of don't mention those. If you ever had to write your life story, you'd be like, okay, here's a good part of the story. Now let's just fast forward 20 years because we don't want to talk about those years. I lived in Oklahoma those years and it was terrible. And Oklahoma jokes. All right. If you're from Oklahoma, I'm sorry. I apologize. One day, all those broken things are going to be undone. They're going to be reconciled. The part of you that has trouble trusting other people, the blood of Jesus wants to reconcile that and fix that. The part of you that never has anything nice to say about yourself, and you say hurtful things. No one says, there are some things that we say about ourselves, no one else has ever said such nasty things about us. God wants to reach in, cover you with the blood of Jesus. And reconcile that. Let me tell you, you don't have to wait for the trumpet to sound for that to happen. The blood of Jesus is already available for you today. Please listen to me. God today wants to reconcile some broken things in you. He wants to undo whatever the enemy has done. Maybe some people have hurt you. Maybe you had some parents that, I'm sorry, weren't worth shooting, however you want to describe them, and they hurt you. Some people you trusted and now you don't trust anyone because of how they treated you. God wants to heal you of those things. He wants to reconcile you of all those things. I'm drawing close to a close. I want to tell you this. It is only a matter of time. It's only a matter of time. Goliath, you go ahead and enjoy your shouting in the middle of the valley. You're feeling awfully big and everybody's quaking. You're making quite a scene. Goliath, you go ahead and enjoy that. You know what? You go ahead and live it up and act like you're undefeatable. You go ahead and do that. Because it is only a matter of time before you are undone and all your works are undone. Enemy, go ahead and rejoice over my falling. You go ahead and do that. Rejoice over my failure. Because I believe it's only a matter of time. The Bible, the Word of God tells me, rejoice not against me over, O my enemy. For when I fall, can anybody quote it? For when I fall, I will arise. That's the scripture, all right? Maybe this is one you should learn. Rejoice not against me. Oh, my enemy, for when I fall, I shall arise. That's a promise in Scripture. You go ahead and rejoice over me because the Bible already said, if I fail, I still have the power to rise up again. Enemy, go ahead and point out the strength of your superior ranking. Go ahead and point all that out because none of that actually matters. And when I storm out onto the field, you will see the strength of my God. I will go in the strength of Jesus. And guess what? Nobody's rank compares to the rank of Jesus Christ because He is King of Kings and He is Lord of Lords. Somebody help me. Poor giant. You never stood a chance. Redemption Church, it is only a matter of time before the greatest struggle that you have becomes your greatest testimony. Somebody know what I'm talking about? I've got these things in my life that I thought I never want somebody to know about this deep, dark struggle in my life. But then that was before I stepped over to victory. You see, when you step over to victory and God fixes those things, now those things you were afraid of letting anybody know about, Katrina, now you can't stop talking about it. Now you can't stop talking about how I was depressed, how I was suicidal, how I thought I had no hope, but then I found the love of Jesus and He cast out all my fear. I can't believe that God's done that for me. I love to tell people about that. But before the victory, oh man, I hid that. I hid that about myself. Can I tell you something? Stop looking at your ranking. It doesn't matter. Stop looking at your bank account. No, seriously. Stop looking at it and fretting. Stop it. Stop looking at the debt and just go, there's no hope. You better cut that out. Stop listening to what others say about you. That's nasty and mean. Stop it. It doesn't matter that no one is saying glowing things about you. It doesn't matter how you rank in this world. You are God's favorite. You are God's chosen. He's called you out of darkness into His marvelous light so that you should show forth the praises of Him. That's what He is doing for you. And it's only a matter of time. See, I really believe this. When that Middle Tennessee Blue Raider team, before they walked out in the locker room, they just made up in their mind, we're not going to worry about what Las Vegas says about our odds. We're not going to worry about what the rankings say. We're not going to worry about even what happens when things get rough. We're going to stick together. We're just going to play our guts out. We're going to leave it all on the court. And we're going to play like champions today. When you feel that way, can I tell you, it's only a matter of time before you're crowned a victor. It's only a matter of time before your enemy is undone. Stop buying into the sentence, poor me. It's not poor you. It's poor Goliath. It's poor giant. You never stood a chance. Oh, man. Poor me, I'm outmatched. Poor me, I have to face a giant. Poor me, I don't have armor like him. Poor me, you better stop believing that lie. Is our God powerful enough to save? Yes. Is our God's word true? Yes. Are His promises true? Yes. All 5,467 promises? Yes. Yes. Does God want to do something for you today? Do you believe that? Yes. You believe that? Right now, over this house, could you just stand? We do three things every time we come. We've worshiped together. We've received the word of together. Now it's time to do the third thing. And here's what I want us to do today. I want to challenge you to take a step forward to this altar area. Now, if that's not what you want to do today, no big deal. Nobody's going to be weird about that. But I want you to take a step forward. And while you're doing it, I want you to just believe that even coming to God in prayer, that you're defeating the enemy. I want you to believe that when you come pray today, you're going to find mighty strength and power. I believe that when you talk to God today, your enemy is getting really, really nervous, and he should. Last thing I'm going to say about this here, if you want special prayer, if you had enough of your enemy, if you've had enough of your fear, I want you to come in the first 2 feet of this area. You see where I'm standing right here? You just come in the first 2 feet. That lets us know you want us to pray with you. And I will pray with you today. And I'll just believe with you that God's going to do good things. Why don't you go ahead and come? Wherever you are in this room, pray to God. Let's spend some time talking. We won't spend all day here, but we will spend some time talking to God in this house. Come on.
For more information about Redemption, look us up online at redemption-church.com. We want to hear from you, so be sure to connect with us on Facebook, Twitter, or even our anonymous question text line at 214-856-0550. Thank you for joining us, and have a blessed day.